Thanking the organizers for giving me the opportunity to talk to you about this work here. I think this conference has a very nice theme, groups of dynamical origin. And we'll see a lot of, well, countable groups of dynamical origin. And here I want to talk to you about some uncountable groups of dynamical origin, but which still have some nice topology. So these are called Polish groups. So I will just write down the definition here. Polish group is a separable topological group. And you want its topology to admit a compatible metric. In particular, it's a metrizable group whose topology admits a compatible complete okay, and I hope I will convince you that even though these are not countable discrete groups, they are still nice, and we can still say a lot of things. So the point of this the fact that we get uncountable groups will really come from the fact that I am from the measurable side of things. And in the measurable world, I mean the natural object that you have is the measure algebra, which is you look at Borel sets up to measure zero. And then, I mean, this is just an uncountable set, as opposed to the algebra of Kloppen sets of a Cantor space. And this is why somehow you will get uncountable objects. Okay, so let me get started with measurable dynamics. So I will work with X mu. For me, it will be just a standard probability space without atoms. So you can think of it as an isomorphic copy of 0,1 equipped with the Lebesgue measure. But often it will be, if you want to make a group act, it's sometimes useful to have other models, just like for the Cantor space. I will completely ignore null sets. And also, when I talk about a set, I will actually mean a Borel set, okay? So these are the standing assumptions. And so let's see what is measurable dynamic. So the most basic objects you can look at are Borel bijections of your space X. And you say that there are measure-preserving transformations, so which I will abbreviate as MPT, if for all A subset of X, the measure of T of A is equal to the measure of A. So let me give you some basic examples. You've got irrational rotations. You take X is 0, 1 with the Lebesgue measure, and you just take any irrational number. The definition would make sense with a rational number, but they are less interesting since they will have only finite orbits. And so you just translate by your irrational number alpha. Okay, and this is a measure-preserving transformation. Another example which we saw is odometers. Okay, odometers are measure-preserving transformations when you really equip your product set with the product like measure, the normalized counting measure. And I won't talk about other methods. So another example is Bernoulli shifts. So you start with a standard probability space, and the space that you will act on is the space of sequences of elements of by infinite sequences of elements of this space Y. So the simplest example, you take Y to be the pair 0,1. And you take like the one half measure. And then you look at the space of by infinite sequences. And you act on this by shifting. So we already saw this action. But so we have our index set N. We have x of n, which is something like this. And then by doing this, you just shift it to the right. And so you can really think in this case of this action as just the action on the space of subsets of Z by translation. Okay, so these are my two basic examples which you will have to keep in mind. And now I want to define up to what I want to look at these measure preserving transformations. So the natural notion is called conjugacy. It just means basically that you're changing the way you look at your probability space. So you say that two transformations T and T prime are conjugate if you have a third measure preserving transformation S such that T is equal to S T prime S inverse. Okay. We're just changing the viewpoint, so let's see some examples. So if you look at irrational rotations, you can look at the map which takes x to minus x mod 1, and this will conjugate t alpha to t minus alpha, which is just t inverse. And actually, one can show that t alpha is conjugate to t beta, if and only if alpha is equal to plus or minus beta modulo 1. So here it's for irrational rotation. Okay. Also, one of the most basic results you can prove is that an irrational rotation is never conjugate to a Bernoulli shift. We will see later that they have zero entropy, and Bernoulli shifts have usually, Bernoulli shifts always have positive entropy, but there are easier ways of seeing this. And Bernoulli shift is also conjugate to its inverse, just you reverse the way you look at the integers. Okay, so I want to introduce a kind of a weaker notion of isomorphism for these measure preserving transformations. So you say that they are flip conjugate if, well, one is conjugate to the other or one is conjugate to the inverse of the other. Okay, so that's just a tiny bit weaker. I mean, there are examples of transformations which are not conjugate to their inverses, so this is really something a bit weaker. Okay, so this is flip conjugacy. Okay, so let's see now, we want to classify these transformations up to flip conjugacy, and so we have to make some, to understand how we can compare them. So one of the most basic things you can look at is ergodicity. So you say that the transformation is ergodic if the only invariant sets have measure 0 or 1. Okay? In another sense, it's indecomposable. And of course, if one transformation is decomposable and the other one is not, then they cannot be flip conjugate. Okay. So that's one invariant. And so let me introduce... So the examples I gave are ergodic, actually. And now another invariant which I want to introduce is what's called the full group of a measure-preserving transformation. So this full group, actually, I think I will copy the definition on this board. So because I want to highlight some similarities, so it will have at some point the topological world. And so here I will write down orbit equivalence, see what this means. Here we'll have flip conjugacy. Okay. So what is the full group of a measurable transformation T? It's just a set of measure-preserving transformations which respect the orbits of the transformation. In other words, you said that U is in the full group of T. So if U is a measure-preserving transformation and U of X is in the T orbit of X for every X. Okay, and so obviously, I mean, this full group, it's an invariant of flip conjugacy, because if you replace T by T inverse, you still have the same orbits. And it's actually an invariant just of the partition of the space into orbits, okay? So, and the associated notion is called orbit equivalence. But so I won't say this in terms of orbit equivalence. I will just say that now you have, okay, maybe I should not put this right away. So now you have another equivalence relation between, you have something finer than, something coarser than flip conjugacy, which is just to say, you say that, you have two transformations T and T prime which are flip conjugate, then obviously their full groups will be conjugate by the same transformation. Okay, so now this gives you a coarser equivalence relation if you want on transformations, and so the theorem of Dye is that this coarser equivalence relation becomes trivial. I mean, if you look at ergodic measure preserving transformations, then their full groups are always isomorphic. Okay, so they're actually, conjugate by the measure-preserving transformation. Okay, so what does this say? Well, it says that if you want to look at full groups as invariants of measure-preserving transformation, then they are not interesting. Okay, for the actions. So that's the thing. I want to fill up this picture. So what do we have in the topological group? So we have T homeomorphism of the Cantor space. And now you can define its, let's say, its big full group, or its big topological full group, or whatever. So what you do, you just use the same definition. You look at the space of homeomorphisms of the Cantor set such that U of X belongs to the T orbit of X for every X. Okay, so that's the big full group. And now I want to introduce the objects that we saw in the Nekrashevich lecture, so these topological full groups. And I want to reformulate a bit what happens for the actions. So for a homeo of the Cantor space, you can view it, of course, as a Z action. And you can look at, in Nekrashevich notation, that would be F of the Cantor set semi-direct Z. So, but I want actually to give another definition of this full group. So let's see. So whenever, let me write it here. So assume that T is aperiodic, and let us see what happens with this U. How can we look at it? Well, we have a co-cycle map. Cycle. And and take U in this full group. Okay, I will write it just as also as brackets T. We have a cocycle map defined by, so Cu from the Cantor space to Z defined by U of X is T to the Cu of X. Of X, okay? U of X is sent to a point in the T orbit of X, and there is a unique integer Cu of X which takes this point, by a power of T, which takes X to this point by a power of T. Okay, so I just have, I have my T orbit. I have X, I have U of X, it's in the same T orbit, and so this is just Cu of X, okay? It's just the integer which goes from here to here. So here, Cu of X is just 2. Okay, and so U is obviously completely defined by this cocycle map. And one way to define this this full group, which I will actually write, I will write it down as T index C, and you will see just why, is just set of U in the big full group of T, such that Cu is U, capital U, is continuous. Okay. So we have this big full group. Elements of these big full groups, they are defined by a cocycle. And what we can do is just put a restriction on the cocycle, and we get this topological full group, which is a countable group. And so the theorem is that this really becomes a complete invariant of Flip conjugacy for minimal transformations. Okay. So now the definition that I will give for the measurable context is, I mean, it's you've probably already guessed it. So now in the measurable context, I take U in the full group of T, and I suppose that T is aperiodic, so infinite orbits. Then I can just look at the cocycle map with the same definition. Okay, so u of x is t to the c u of x. And now, I just want to remark that we have a cocycle identity. So the cocycle of u prime is the cocycle of u prime of x plus c u of u prime of x. So this is just that if you compose, so if you... let's take a bit more space. So here, I suppose that I have... I will write it down here. So let's see, you just have x, and then you go to u prime of x. So to do this, you use the c u prime of x. And then you compose with u. And so here you get u prime of x. So here you use c u of u prime of x. So this is why you have this identity, okay? Okay, so, now I can view these, the elements of the full group as cocycle maps, and now the restriction that I will put on these cocycle maps in this setup is that it is integrable, okay? So the L1 full group of a measure-preserving transformation T is the group of U in the full group of T, whose cocycle is integrable. Okay? So that's the main definition of the talk. My measure preserving. So I still have my space X mu, and T is a measure preserving transformation of X mu. Okay? So I can just integrate this cocycle. Okay? So I will write it here. Actually, by doing so, I'm killing the suspense, but anyway. So I look at the set of U such that X is integrable. Okay, so that's the definition. So the first thing is to check that you indeed, when you've done this, you have a group. So it is the case. So let me just write down why you have this. You take u prime in the L1 full group, and then I told you that cu prime is just u prime of x plus cu of u prime of x. And now when I integrate the absolute value of these guys, I will get this, which is finite by assumption. And then here I have composed by a measure preserving transformation. So I'm just integrating cu of x. So this is also finite. So this is stable under composition. Oh, yeah, sorry. Yeah, thank you. OK, so it's a group. Very good. And now you have a natural metric. I mean, basically what I did is I identified the space of cocycles to a space, I mean, the full group to a space of maps from X to Z. And here I asked that these maps are integrable. In other words, I'm looking at maps in L1 of X taking values into Z. So I have this natural metric on these transformations. I just integrate the difference of the cocycles. And I mean, the interpretation is very, I mean, is nothing, is very natural. I mean, you just have U of X and U prime of X. And I mean, here I have a graph. I mean, here I identify, so suppose like X was here. I just identify the T orbit of X to Z. And on this copy of Z, I have a natural metric. And I'm just integrating the distance between U of X and U prime of X. Okay, so it's a natural thing to look at. And the very good thing is that this metric is separable and complete. So here I'm in a nice shape. It's something actually a bit better than just a Polish group, because here my metric, you can check that it's invariant under right multiplication. And so I have a Polish group with a compatible right invariant complete metric given by this D1. And also this space is separable. I mean, it's just a subspace of this L1 full group is just a subspace of L1 of the measured space, so it's separable. Is it possible? Sorry? No, it will never be locally compact. So actually, I said it's a Polish group, and it's actually a bit better than that, but never mind. And it is uncountable, and actually, so I should give you some examples of elements of the L1 full group. So these you can build. Really, like in the topological context, a very easy way of building elements is just you find a set A such that A and T of A are disjoint. So, yeah, sorry. This is A, this is T of A, this is T. And now, whenever I take a subset of A, then T maps it to that. And I have a natural involution defined by this, which will be T of X on this side, and here T inverse on I am in T of A. Okay, and this I can do whenever, for every subset of A. And this subset of A, I mean, I have uncountably many, and you can use this just to show that it's never locally compact. Because this actually will live in a, I mean, if A is very small, this will live in, these guys will all live in the neighborhood of the identity. And you can use this to show that any compact subset actually has empty interior. So it's not compact and not even locally compact. Okay. Sorry?
It gives path.
You also have you can use. I mean, you can find like index by t an increasing sequence. I mean, okay, you can use this to show that involutions like this are connected to the identity by
it's
a path. Sorry.
So it's
I'm not sure what infinite dimensional means, but. Okay. Okay, so as I said, this is it behaves like topological full groups in the sense that it is an invariant of flip conjugacy. And so you have the following theorem. So, I mean, for those who are not familiar with topological full groups, this may seem a bit strange, but for the other ones, it's not very surprising. So, what do we have? We have that T is flip conjugate to T prime for ergodic transformations, if and only if their L1 full groups are topologically isomorphic, if and only if their L1 full groups are abstractly isomorphic. So, of course, when you want to prove a statement like this, I mean, you clearly have that this implies this implies this. So, you will start with an abstract isomorphism between these L1 full groups, and you will want to say something about flip conjugacy. So you have two steps. The first step is what's called a reconstruction result. So basically, whenever you take a group of measure transformations with sufficiently many involutions, you will have that any abstract isomorphism between such groups has to be the conjugacy between the conjugacy by a measure-preserving transformation. So here, there is a kind of reconstruction theorem, which tells you that if you have an abstract isomorphism, it must come from the conjugacy by a measure-preserving transformation. Okay. So once you're there, you started with TNT prime, and now you know that there is a measure-preserving transformation which conjugates actually this guy to this guy. Okay. And now you want to conclude that T and T prime are a flip conjugate, and that's exactly the content of a result of Belinskaya from 69. So she proved that if you have the same L1 full group, then you have to be flip conjugate. Okay, and yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, which part? This part or this part? No. So it's really, I mean, what I do is I go from 3 to 1 directly. So the thing is that, I mean, yeah, you have two parts. So the isomorphism comes from the conjugacy by a measure-preserving transformation. So this is really because your group, in some sense, is big. It has many involutions, so basically you can characterize, I mean, you can recover your measurable subsets, in a sense, from the group. And then, I mean, you build like a measure-preserving transformation like this. And then, yes, there's this rigidity result from Belinskaya, which, I mean, has a topological analog, which is due to Boyle, and which says that if two minimal homeomorphisms have the same topological full group, then they are flip conjugate. I'm not. I mean, yeah, you. No, because the. I mean, you don't know what S does to the topology. I mean, the topology does not really come from the topology, the weak topology on out of X mu or so. No, but so you have a topology on out of X mu, a polished topology, the weak topology. But the point is that the topology that I introduced here, it is much finer than this topology. So yeah, actually you have two topologies on out of X mu. You have this weak topology. You have this uniform topology, which gives you a polished topology on this full group. But then this topology, it's really finer, so you don't know how it behaves with respect to it. A priori. No, we will see that it's not shortly. No, and we'll see that also shortly. Okay, so once you have this result, natural question is basically, you have built a new invariant for measure-preserving transformations, which is nice. But now you want to say to people from measurable dynamics, this invariant is actually useful. So you must prove something. So one thing you can do is introduce, you can look at the following invariant for Polish groups, or separable topological groups, actually. You can look at how many elements you need to generate a dense subgroup. So the fact that your group is separable tells you that you can always take countably many elements to have a dense subgroup, but then maybe you only need finitely many, and that's the topological rank, okay? So that's an invariant, and then the topological rank, then it's the topological rank of the L1 full group becomes an invariant for measure-preserving transformations, for any measure-preserving transformation. Okay. So, but now you need to say something about it, and And so here is what I can say about it. So if you take a measure-preserving ergodic transformation, then the cell one full group has finite topological rank, so it has a finite set generating a dense subgroup, if and only if the transformation has finite entropy. Okay, so this I will explain right away what is entropy. But entropy, I mean, is a well-known and useful invariant. So, okay, you can tell people from measurable dynamics that at least this has something to do with an important invariant. Okay, so let me recall what is entropy. So for this, I want to, I won't give you the usual definition, but I will give you an equivalent one. So first, I need to define what is an observable. So it's just a Borel map from your space X into a countable set. So from a kind of physical perspective, you just have X, you have a lot of particles in them, and you want to measure something about these particles, and it takes range in the countable set, let's say. Okay, so let's see what happens when... So you have this random X, and so you apply to it your observable, and you want to quantify the amount of information you got from knowing that phi of x is equal to I for some I in your x set. And so, it turns out that the only natural answer is up to a multiplicative constant, a positive multiplicative constant, is to take minus the logarithm of the measure of phi inverse of I. And this is just, basically the thing is that if you had two independent observables, you want to say that the amount of information of their product is the sum, and then, you know that these measures, they will multiply, and you want to have something additive, so you put a log. If I take two observables, phi and psi, and I view them as you have the product observable, you just look at phi of x, psi of x, and saying that they are independent is to say that the measures of these guys would be product measures. So, okay. So we have these observables, and now what is the entropy of an observable? It's just the mean amount of information it provides. Okay, so you look at your x; it belongs to some phi of x is equal to some I, and what is the measure of the set of X? This is just the measure of the set of X such that phi of X is equal to I. And so here, the quantity of information I get for such X is minus log of this quantity. Okay? So it's really just the average of this, which is this function from X to the reals. Okay. So that's the entropy of an observable, and now I want to really define what happens when I have a measure-preserving transformation. So I want to relate observables to measure-preserving transformations. So I will say that an observable is dynamically generating if, whenever I have x different from y, then actually, using the dynamics, I can using the dynamics and the observable, I can differentiate these two points. Okay, so this is just this phi of tn of x is different from phi of tn of y for some n. Okay, and that's really equivalent to say that you look at the smallest t invariant sigma algebra generated by phi. And this is the whole sigma algebra up to measure zero. Okay, now I can give you the definition, which is not at all the original definition of entropy, but which is easy to state. So this definition actually is due to Rochlin. So the entropy of a measure-preserving transformation is just the infimum of the entropies of the dynamically generating observables. Okay, so you have these specific observables which if you use the dynamics given by T, allow you to differentiate points, and you just look at the one with, I mean, the infimum of their entropies. Okay, so let me give the fundamental example. So let me consider again Bernoulli shifts, and here, for simplicity, I take Y to be a countable atomic probability space. And then I have a natural observable, which is just I look at what happens at the coordinate zero. And then, I mean, it's easy to see that this observable is dynamically generating. The theorem is that the entropy of the Bernoulli shift will be equal to the entropy of this specific observable. And so what I just said was, I explained why you have this inequality, that h of t will be less than that, but I mean you have to go the other way around. And that's the work of Kolmogorov-Sinai and also of Rochlin, which basically then showed this, gave this alternate definition. Okay. So now, I want to explain to you so the proof of this theorem, so that the L1 full group has finite topological rank if and only if the transformation has finite entropy. So I will give you first an other example of maps that you have in the L1 full group. So these are called induced transformations. So let me just recall that these are what these are. So whenever I have a measure-preserving transformation and I take a subset of X, you have a Poincaré's recurrence theorem, which tells you that almost every point of A will at some point be sent again to A by your transformation T. Okay, and then you give the smallest such n a name, you call it Na of X, and okay, you say it's equal to zero for X not in A. And so here is a theorem of Katch, which tells you that actually, so this this map here, this Na, it is an integrable map. Okay. And this is very nice for us because actually we can, there's a well-known definition of the induced transformation on a set A, which is just given by this equation. So here, yeah, I changed my slide. I mean, you can, I mean, Ta of X, this is the definition everywhere. So everywhere equal to T to be N of X, T to be Na of X of X. And okay, so this theorem here, it just tells me that my induced transformation T, well, it is in the L1 full group, okay? Because I mean this is always less than one, okay? So that's nice. We have an old theorem which gives us elements of the L1 full group. I should say that actually the phenomenon is much more general. Namely, whenever you take an element of the L1 full group and you look at its induced transformation, the induced transformation will still belong to the L1 full group. And actually, to prove this, you just basically redo the proof of this theorem. I mean, it's the same proof. Okay. But anyway, now we have two kinds of elements. We have these involutions, and we have these induced transformations. And the point of these induced transformations is that they tell us that whenever we have a subset X, subset A of X, and say whenever we had that T was aperiodic, so infinite orbits, then we have a transformation TA, which is non-trivial exactly on A. Okay, so this tells us that we have many elements in TA, yeah, let's write it like this. We have many elements in this L1 full group. Okay, so now I can explain to you why if the topological rank of the L1 full group is finite, then the entropy must be finite. So, okay, so I start with finitely many elements which generate a dense subgroup, so let me call them U1 to UN. And so, okay, what are the observables that I want to look at? It's this co-cycle maps, okay, this CUI. And so each of these CUI, it has finite entropy. And now you have a nice property of entropy, which is that it is subadditive. And, okay, and yeah, so this, I mean, the fact that every integrable observable has finite entropy is not a trivial fact. I mean, in a sense, it's well known to people who work in entropy theory, but it's, I mean, and the proof is not so hard, but you need to know that it's true. but it is true. And so then you have these co-cycle maps, you put them together and you get something of finite entropy. Okay. And then what you want to do, of course, with the definition which I gave you of entropy is to check that this observable is dynamically generating. So this will actually follow from two things. So the first is just that when you take elements of the closed group generated by U1 to UN, their co-cycle is measurable with respect to the T invariant sigma algebra generated by these guys. Okay, recall that I told you that to be dynamically generating just means that the T invariant sigma algebra generated by you by your elements is the whole sigma algebra. So okay, so this is just something to check, and it's not hard. Here you already saw what happens with I don't have the formula anymore, but okay. So the second thing is you need to know also that that you have many elements in the L1 full group of T. And actually, so I just told you that for every A in X, the set A, if I look at the induced transformation on A, then A is exactly the set of X such that CU of X is not equal to zero. Okay, so this tells me that actually, every A in X will belong, subset of X will belong to this T invariant sigma algebra. In other words, I really have a dynamically generating observable. Okay, so this proves one implication. And now I will do the other implication. And actually, to do the other implication, I will need to introduce some more elements. So I will introduce a smaller group, which is easier to understand, which is the derived L1 full group. So what is it? It's just a closed subgroup generated by commutators. Okay. So I just write it is at brackets T1 prime. Okay. So you need to understand how far this group is from the L1 full group. And to understand this, you define something called the index map. So what is the index map? Well, I have these co-cycle maps which are integrable. And what can I do then? I can just take their integral. And this, I call it the index of my transformation U. So a basic example is that the index of t to the n is just n. So the cocycle identity will tell you that the index is a group homomorphism taking values into R. And when t is ergodic, you can show that it actually takes values into z. So, and you can show this actually quite easily, but I don't have time to explain. But you can use a mass transport principle to show this. Okay, so that's the index, and what's the result? It's just that the derived L1 full group is the kernel of this index map. Okay, so here note that you have a much nicer situation than in the case of topological full groups. I mean, you want to compute the topological abelianization of your L1 full group, and it's just always Z for an ergodic transformation. So the situation is really simple. Okay, so I have this smaller group. And I told you that I understand it better. So why? So it's because, I mean, answering Yves' question, this derived L1 full group is topologically generated by involutions. And but this actually, I should say that the proof is completely, I mean, it uses something called the commutator trick. And I have really no upper bound. I mean, first, I don't know if you can remove the topologically here. And yeah, and that's all. I mean, and something even stronger could be to have a kind of bound on the number of involutions given on the depending on the distance from the identity. But this is very far from possible at the moment. Okay, but nevertheless, it's topologically generated by involutions, and there are a few additional facts, so which I will just tell you. So it actually you can show that this is the connected component of the identity. I mean, it's not hard from what I told you already. It is actually generated as a group by periodic elements, so elements having only finite orbits. And also, this is topologically simple if and only if the transformation is ergodic. And furthermore, it is never simple. And this is not. I mean, there is a nice trick to see that it's never simple, but I don't have time to go into it. Okay. So, I told you that the L1 full group is the derived L1 full group is topologically generated by involutions. So. Here I gave you examples of simple evolution involutions. So you just have A, T of A, which are disjoint. You take T on A and T inverse on T of A. So I just wrote the definition here again, the precise definition of these involutions. And actually, adapting some work of Kittrell Trunkov that they had done on these full groups, you can show that these guys form a set of generators, of topological generators. And so, then using some work that Marx did for full groups, you can show that the topological rank of the L1 full group of an irrational rotation is equal to 2, actually. Okay, and these irrational rotations have entropy 0. You can also show the same thing, actually, for the odometer. And, okay, now I switch to topological full groups a bit. So to prove the theorem, I should say that I need really to use topological full groups at the moment. They are completely unavoidable, and I will tell you why. So I take an aperiodic homeomorphism of the Cantor space, and I take mu to be an invariant probability measure. And so the result is that the involutions from this topological full group, they generate a dense subgroup of this derived L1 full group. Okay, and so the proof is very simple. I mean, you just approximate these guys by ITU, where U is Kloppen, and ITU will be in your topological full group. Okay. Okay, but note that this is a priori just for the derived derived L1 full group, but now, of course, we know that the whole L1 full group is just the derived group plus this transformation T. And I mean, here I already have my transformation T in the topological full group. So I can conclude that the topological full group for a transformation T is always dense in the L1 full group. Okay, so now let me explain why you have this other implication, why if the entropy is finite, the topological rank is finite. So actually, so there's a deep theorem of Krieger that we have to use, which tells us that we can put us in the situation from the previous slide. And here, yeah, this is a mistake, just a minimal subshift. This is all I want. So we can assume that T is a minimal subshift on the Cantor space. And then you have a result of Matoui, which actually was recently generalized in a crazy generality by Nekrashevich, which tells you that this derived topological full group is finitely generated. And so we conclude that this the derived L1 full group is finitely generated, and we just add the transformation T, and we get that the L1 full group is topologically finitely generated. Okay. Do I have like 5 more minutes or? Let me state the theorem again. So what we actually can prove is that the L1 full group has finite topological rank if and only if the derived L1 full group has finite topological rank, if and only if T has finite entropy. And so a natural question would be to know whether, I mean, you can really relate whether this topological rank completely depends on entropy or whether it is something different. I mean, and I really have no idea or opinion. I mean, I have a very changing opinion. And I mean, basically, the thing is that I cannot say anything about like the simplest examples of Bernoulli shifts, like give explicit examples. So it's, I mean, it's hard to decide. And okay, so that's a natural question. And yeah, so then I will just do the last slide anyway. So you can make sense of all I said in a more general context. I mean, suppose that now you have gamma countable group, and you have an action on X mu, which is free and measure preserving. And suppose that actually gamma is finitely generated. Then, I mean, you have a Cayley graph with respect to some generating set, some finite generating set. And you can view, I mean, then you can put on every orbit, on every gamma orbit, graph structure. And you can just replace my previous condition just by saying that you want that now the distance from x to s to u of x in the Cayley graph is integrable. Or if you want to say it in terms of cocycles, you still have for a free action a cocycle map, and you want it to be, you want to, its absolute value with respect to your generating set to be integrable. Then you can define the L1 full group of a finitely generated group, or actually I should say more generally of a graphing, but the result that I want to tell you is that with so Carderi, Matebon, and Sankoff, so using some great work from Seward and Nekrashevich, we could actually completely generalize this previous result, but only to the derived L1 full group. So it is equivalent for the derived L1 full group to have finite topological rank and for the action to have finite Rochlin entropy. And there are many, many questions. I mean, I just defined the thing like 1 year ago, and you can ask a lot of questions, and one of them is just to know for a finitely generated group whether the topological full group is always dense in the L1 full group. I have no, I really have no clue at all. So, another thing I should say is I also don't know what is the abelianization of this L1 full group in general. I mean, the proof really only works for Z and uses a specific, I mean, the fact that basically, you can, if you remove a point from Z, then you cut it into two pieces, a positive part and a negative part. And I mean, in general, there's no... So I'll stop here. Thank you.